Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your affording me the opportunity to address an issue with profound implications for the exercise of human rights in the OSCE region and across the globe, ensuring a free and open internet. This hearing is emblematic of the Commission's strong defense and dedicated promotion of human rights principles enshrined in the core of the Helsinki Final Act and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. I valued the opportunity to work with members of the Commission and your superb staff. The Commission's efforts greatly strengthened my hand and that of Assistant Secretary Posner and our colleagues at the State Department as we work with other governments, civil society advocates, and the private sector to defend and advance human rights and democratic governance. Can I also take a moment to thank you for inviting the other witnesses you've welcomed here today? I'm thrilled to be here with my friends David and Dunya, both of whom I admire a great deal, and also with Mr. Rosinski and Mr. Siegel. I feel honored to be in such great company, and I know that Mr. Lee will share his views too, and I'm glad for that. Mr. Chairman, I endeavored in my written testimony to respond to your specific requests and to highlight key trends and concerns regarding a number of countries in the OSCE region, many of which you just highlighted yourself, as well as to describe what we are doing institutionally within the OSCE to protect and advance internet freedom. And I'd like to make just a few brief general comments here and then take whatever specific questions you might have. First, I want to say a few words about why we, the United States, are committed to internet freedom. The United States champions internet freedom because it derives from universal and cherished rights, the freedoms of speech, assembly, and association. An open internet gives people a neutral platform from which to express their legitimate aspirations and shape their own destinies. As Secretary Clinton has emphasized, the rights of individuals to express their views freely, petition their leaders, worship according to their beliefs, these rights are universal, whether they are exercised in a public square or in an individual blog. The freedoms to assemble and associate also apply in cyberspace. In our time, people are as likely to come together to pursue common interests online as in a church or a labor hall. As we all know, the internet and other new technologies are having a profound effect on the ability to organize citizen movements around the world. And because repressive regimes understand this power, they are redoubling their efforts to control it. Recently, in Vilnius, on the margins of the Community of Democracies ministerial meeting, Secretary Clinton and I met with a number of activists, including several from the OSCE region, who spoke of the surveillance, hacking, and harassment they face every day. As Assistant Secretary Posner said earlier this week, these are the acts of governments that fear their own people. In cracking down on the internet, they expose their own lack of legitimacy. But speech is harder than ever to control in the digital age, and young people who have taken to the streets this year understand that it isn't pornography or pirating that's being suppressed. It's people and their legitimate demands for dignity and a say in the political and economic futures of their countries. As President Obama said in Cairo back in 2009, suppressing ideas never succeeds in making them go away. The actions of these governments remind us of a basic truth. Governments that respect their citizens have no reason to fear when citizens exercise their rights. And governments that respect the rights of their citizens have no reason to fear a free internet. Of course, repressive governments are also missing out. The internet can be a force for social and political stability if governments use it as a way to better communicate with their citizens and to serve them in an open and transparent fashion. The internet offers an early warning signal for public discontent and therefore a way to address grievances before they erupt into protests. As Assistant Secretary Posner said, governments should not shoot the instant messenger. They should address the underlying problems that cause citizens to lose faith in their governments and in the future. Mr. Chairman, we are not cyber utopians who believe that the internet is the magic answer to the world's human rights problems. Technology does not change the world. People must. And we must not forget that calls for freedom still spring from human dreams and resonate in human hearts, even if they are shared by keystrokes and text messages. That's why we take a person-centered approach. Through our diplomacy, through direct support for embattled activists worldwide, we are helping people stay one step ahead of the censors, the hackers, and the brutes who beat them up or imprison them for what they do online. Since 2008, thanks to Congress's support, we have committed $50 million in direct support for activists on the front lines of the struggle against internet repression. By the end of 2011, we will have allocated $70 million toward these efforts. Our programming responds to the most urgent priorities we hear from activists on the ground, including embattled democracy and human rights activists from the OSCE countries. We're committed to a free and open internet because it follows from our commitments to fundamental freedoms and universal values. These commitments, like all human rights commitments, are part of who we are, part of, as the title of this hearing suggests, the promises we keep. And of course, it's also part of the promises at the center of the OSCE. Mr. Chairman, as you know, the OSCE was the first regional organization to recognize that respect for human rights, pluralistic democracy, and the rule of law are prerequisites for a lasting order of security and prosperity. And the OSCE was the first regional organization to acknowledge the vital importance of civil society. The Helsinki process must continue to be a pioneer for human dignity, civil society, and democratic government in the digital age. Challenges to internet freedom in the OSCE region are illustrative of the issues we are addressing across the globe. Mr. Chairman, as you know, in the past, the Helsinki process was a major international platform for defending citizens expressing dissenting views via samizdat and for protesting the jamming of radio broadcasts. Today, email, social networking, and text messaging are new forms of samizdat, as well as indispensable tools of commerce, education, and global communications. As the United States has done since the inception of the Helsinki process, so too, in this new century, we stand with those in the OSCE region who seek to peacefully exercise their fundamental freedoms and promote and protect human rights, including via new technologies. The United States will take every opportunity to work with the Lithuanian chair, the EU, and other participating states and civil society to ensure that the OSCE sends a clear message from Vilnius on internet freedom. If I were to distill that message into a tweet to the world, it would be enduring freedom, new apps. Mr. Chairman, when he signed the Helsinki Final Act 35 years ago, President Ford famously said that history will judge this conference not by what we say here today, but by what we do tomorrow. Not by the promises we make, but by the promises we keep. He was right then, and his statement is even more true today. In this digital age, keeping our promises greatly depends on ensuring that the internet is open and free. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the Commission. I'd be glad to take your questions.